heads. Heavenly Father, we come giving you the praise, giving you the glory and the honor to your holy righteous name. We come, God, because Friday was a dark day in many aspects, God. Evil seemed to have triumphed over good. Wrong seemed to have gotten the best of right. Those who had earthly power seemed to have overwhelmed those who were poor and meek, God. But yet, God, we know that things are not always as they seem to be, that you have your own plan. You have your own way of making things right. So we thank you, God, that you saw fit to offer up your only begotten Son on Friday, God, realizing that you were going to have him make the ultimate sacrifice, God, for the greater common good. We thank you, God, that he stayed in the grave all night long. We thank you, God, that even on what was perceived back then to be their Sabbath day, God, he stayed in the grave all night long. But then, God, we just so thankful today that early on Sunday morning, early before the crack of dawn, before the cock could crow, you saw fit, God, to raise him from the dead, to breathe life back into his body, to raise him up, God, so that mankind would have a Savior, to raise him up, God, so that we could be reconciled once more to you, to raise him up, God, so that he could return from whence he first came, to raise him up, God, so that those who have no hope could be full of hope. Those who were bludgeoned down by despair, God, could rejoice and know that victory is assured. We thank you, God, for that victory. We thank you, God, for that love. We thank you, God, that you still sit high and look low. And that now, God, we have a way back home. You have claimed us for yourself. We belong to you, God. And so the rest of this day, indeed for the rest of our lives, we cannot help but give you praise. We cannot help but lift up holy hands. We cannot help but open up our mouths and sing glory, hallelujah to the risen King. Bless us now, God. Bless the man servant who will come and break the word of life. Empower him, God. You've been a special anointing on him all week long, God. Through the funerals, God. Even as we preached during the Holy Week, you were with him, God. Now we pray, God, that you would touch him again early this morning. And then, God, be with him at 10 o'clock. And then, God, after he has preached from the fullness of the gospel, we pray, God, that you will give him joy, a joy that the world cannot give and the world cannot take away. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The scripture this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. I will be reading from the New Living Translation. The resurrection. But very early on Sunday morning, the women came to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone covering the entrance had been rolled aside. So they went in, but they couldn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. They were puzzled, trying to think what could have happened to it. Suddenly, two men appeared to them, dazzled in white robes. The women were terrified and bowed low before them. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking in a tomb for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen from the dead.
Right.
Don't you remember what he told you back in Galilee? That the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again the third day. Then they remembered that he had said this. So they rushed back to tell the 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. The women who went to the tomb were Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and several others. They told the apostles what had happened, but the story sounded like nonsense, so they didn't believe it. However, Peter ran to the tomb to look. Stooping, he peered in and saw empty linen wrappings. Then he went home again, wondering what had happened. My brothers and sisters, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
So loved the world that he gave his only son. The son gave his life on Calvary, that you and I might be free. No greater love, no greater love than a man would lay down his life for a friend. There is no greater love, no greater love than a man would lay down his life for a friend. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. The son gave his life way out on Calvary so that you and I, we might than a man would lay down his life for a friend. There is no greater love. I searched all over and I found him. No greater love, yeah, than a man would lay down his life for a friend. Thank you. They hung him high, they stretched him wide. He hung his head, for me he died. That's love, that's love. They hung him high, they stretched him wide.
This opportunity and preaching privilege, I would like to certainly thank Dr. Fitzjeffries and to his lovely wife and to my good friend, Pastor Allen of Shallow Baptist Church, and to all of you, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, and to other pastors who have gathered. We thank you and we say to you, Happy Easter. We are glad to be in the house one more time. And we certainly are thankful for all of you who have over the years supported this coming together of three churches, New Zion and St. Matthew's and Shiloh. And this particular tradition spans about 60 some odd years, and it is still going on. See my good breakfast buddy over there. Good to see you. It has spanned those number of years and continues the rich tradition. And for that, we are eternally thankful. Let us pray, God. We ask your blessings now, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my Redeemer and my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
Also thankful for the choir getting up early this morning, and amen. Come on. Amen. And we are thankful also for the Usher Ministry. Let's give them a hand. Thank you. You look beautiful. Then arose Peter and ran to the sepulcher, and stooping down, he beheld the linen laid by themselves and departed, wondering in himself at that which was come to pass. I want to talk this morning about reopening a cold case. Reopening a cold case. There was a series that spanned from 2002 to 2010, over 100 series, and it was called Cold Case. I was intrigued by the perseverance of those who sought out the truth. Evidence was scattered, and when a person has done all they can do, they call that a cold case. No one has been found, and it lays in some file somewhere, resting for a number of years. There is no empirical evidence that would bring someone to justice. They call that a cold case. A cold case is one which the investigation into an accident has been closed because of lack of evidence, witness, and public demand. Cases are generally closed when a suspect has been arrested. Sometimes cases are closed, but no one believes the report. So in the public perception, the case grows cold. We've heard of many notorious cold cases. Jack the Ripper, they're still looking for Jimmy Hoffa. He's somewhere in some cement. John Benet Ramsey, Chandra Levy, Natalie Holloway, and dozens of others come to our attention because they have occupied our time and our interest over the years. Cases get closed for a variety of reasons, such as previously available technology that we have today that was not there for us years ago. They can analyze, and sometimes out of that particular effort, the evidence emerges from the findings, and witnesses sometimes become hostile and uncooperative, and various time constraints hinders the investigation. Heavy workloads for law enforcement have been named as the culprit. The most common is lack of worthwhile leads that stalls the case. Sometimes cold cases involve death, sometimes robberies, sometimes unexplained events, missing persons. The number of cold cases seems to grow every year. According to the FBI, over 6,000 new cold case files every year. The agency says that there are over 200,000 cold case files that have accumulated over 50 years. Our community was excited in 2008 when it heard about 100 cold cases involving civil rights atrocities that were reopened with the availability of new technology just in search of the truth. A cold case can be solved as long as there is evidence, witness, and a public that has not given up on the case. Where are you going with this, Pastor? On Easter Sunday in Jerusalem, 2,000 years ago, Peter began an inspection of an empty tomb that reopens a cold case. There are witnesses even today, there is plenty of evidence and there's plenty of public interest, but that's all that the world is talking about. As Christians, as children of God, as those who claim exclusive rights to sonship and relationship, we are interested in this cold case. The truth we've learned about the resurrection of our Savior has proven to be the very foundation of our faith. By reopening the cold case, we learn that he lives. Is there anybody in here this morning? You are confident. There is not a debatable issue. You are certain in your mind that we serve a living Christ. By reopening this cold case, we affirm the resurrection that he lives. This particular text that we bring before you on an inspection made by Peter on the morning of resurrection, an inspection of what he thought was a cold case, but ultimately left him wondering about what he saw. Christ had been crucified and buried in a new tomb. Had it been borrowed from a wealthy man in the area named Joseph? His body had been hastily removed from the cross so that it would not be hanging during the Passover. And on Sunday morning, the women came to the tomb and found the body gone. Their report was dismissed because the case was closed. They had watched Christ die on the cross. They heard him and his words from the cross, "It is finished." They watched him removed and buried in the tomb. They watched the mighty stone rolled in front of the tomb. The case was obviously closed. However, the report of the women suggested that the case ought to be reopened. Something looks suspicious. Something looks funny. Something looks out of place. Something, the evidence and the word that we got was that he was dead. So we are going to prepare the body. Obviously, there must be evidence that would lead to a different conclusion if verified. Realizing that there had been no close inspection of the cross, the tomb. Peter then ran to the tomb to make his own investigation. Sometimes in life, you just want to see for yourself. There are things in life that you don't take the word of everybody because everybody can't be trusted. There are some things I want to see with my own eyes. There are some things that I want to feel for myself. I want to walk in. I want to see the place where the Lord lay. And realizing that there had been no closer inspection of the cross or the tomb, Peter decides that I'm going to investigate for myself. And once inside, he saw absolutely nothing but the strips of linen cloth that were used to wrap the body of Jesus. The cloth strips were neatly folded and all lying by themselves. He was extremely specific in his observation, taking note that of every detail that he saw with his own eyes, not counting on the testimony of the women. The Bible says that he left wondering in himself the thing that had come to pass. He left no wiser than when he came. It was enough to confirm that the cause of Christianity was not over. It did not end at Calvary. The cross and the tomb had not quenched the divine fire that burned deep within him. He left that morning convinced that there was sufficient evidence enough to reopen this cold case. There are many who believe that those who trust God are borderline fanatics. I've heard them over and over again, Reverend. I don't know if I really believe what you believe. They are ignoring the facts of the case. They believe that the case of Jesus ended on a hill called Golgotha some 2,000 years ago. They say that the facts of this case are that a man named Jesus was crucified on a Roman cross, and the end of the story is that he died. They point to the cross. They point to the nails. Come on now. They consider the crown of thorns placed on his head. They heard the last words of Jesus say that it is finished, as evidenced that Jesus is dead. Back in 66, when I finished high school, there was a stirring about. Time magazine shocked the world by asking the question, is God dead? They maintained that God was no longer necessary to explain the natural order of things. They also noted that God plays an honorable role in the lives of people rather than an obligatory role of master. For all purposes, they claimed that God was dead because there is no evidence that he lives. But the Bible says the fool shall say in his heart that there is no God. You ought to be able to look around and gather sufficient evidence that God lives. Do I have a witness in the house? Yet today, we who believe submit that God is not dead. We further submit that Jesus has been raised from the dead. And to prove our case, let's reopen this cold case. Can I take just a few minutes to reopen the case? There is evidence that Jesus lives. There is evidence of Jesus' earthly existence. On Easter Sunday morning, several women, including Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, came to the tomb. They found the body of Jesus was mysteriously missing. But there was a presence there, someone in glittering garments who said, he's not here, but he's risen. The disciples later saw the empty tomb. They saw the folded linen. They spoke to him on the road to Emmaus as the travelers were returning home. Another stride with them. And they watched him eat the fish and bread in front of them. And hundreds watched as he took a cloud and ascended back to heaven. The evidence is irrefutable to those who say that he's dead. We say that this is a cold case that needs to be reopened. And even today, the evidence of God's movement in our lives is undeniable. Those who have faced, if you've ever been through something, walk with me just a minute. If you ever endured something, if you've ever overcome impossible situations by the help of God, that gives evidence of his living presence. If you've ever been a cancer survivor, if you've ever had the doctors shake their head and walk away and say that there is no hope, if you've ever been down and out, down to your last dime, weeping all night long, but you got up in the morning and somehow God cast the dark clouds of despair away, you ought to be able to tell somebody that you serve not a dead God, but one who is alive, one who extends himself, meets me at the point of my need. Stood by the roadside of life, but now you're standing tall on your feet. You ought to be able to know that God hears and answers prayer. We don't always understand his ways. We don't understand why there are walls and rumors of walls and phantom. We don't understand why there is pestilence and disease, why there are trials and troubles. But we are able to see enough evidence in the world to know that when a prayer breaks through the clouds of confusion and frustration that cloaks in this world, God moves and God saves and God heals and God answers prayer. Oh, I wish I had a praying church. Somebody who's been down through life's trials and tribulation, have gone through vicissitudes of life, but you walk through and come out on the other side realizing that if God brings you to it, he's able to bring you through it. You can wave back and shout like others in this world. We've had trials and tribulation, but you ought to be of good cheer because the Lord has already overcome the world. The angel invites Mary to bear witness to the reality of the resurrection. They were invited to see the empty tomb and the blood-stained sheet. They were invited to see the folded napkin. Yeah, they were invited to investigate the interior of the tomb and see for themselves. An eyewitness does not repeat secondhand information, but they want to call it firsthand information because I saw it for myself. And even today, there are millions of witnesses who can testify about the goodness of the Lord. And I believe that they are sitting in here this morning on resurrection morning because they've tried him for themselves. There's no witness like a witness who can say, I've seen it with my own eyes. Do I have a witness? That's why the angel invited the women to come see the place where the Lord lay. The angel wanted them to be in a position to speak with authority. We who have been down to our last dime, we who have faced tragedy, despair, can testify that the Lord is good.
Yeah, we who have stood on the brink of death only to be snatched back from the jaws of destruction ought to be able to testify that God will be a shield around you every day. We who've weathered some hurricanes and some gale force winds of life, we're best able to testify that God is a shelter in the time of a storm. You and I, who have been dismissed as dead and beyond help, we can rejoice in the resurrection morning. We can testify that I know God lives. Why do you know He lives? Because, Reverend, He woke me up this morning. He touched me with His finger of love. I felt the warmth of His smile. I know He lives because He lit the sun, hung it in the heavens. I know He lives because I tried Him for myself. Has anybody in here tried Him for yourself? You've gathered the evidence of a living God. Well, even if the evidence is undeniable and the witnesses are unavailable, the cold case remains cold. If there is no interest in reopening the case, on the day following the crucifixion, there was very little interest among the Romans for reopening the cold case. The scribes and the Pharisees refused to talk about it. They didn't want to deal with it. Pilate washed his hands, but he couldn't wash his heart. And while they refused to talk about it, investigate or explore the implications, there were thousands who refused to believe the official account. Their numbers grew by the thousands as they announced their faith in God. Yeah, and God raising Jesus from the dead. Well, I'm almost finished, but the day, my brothers and my sisters, there are about 1.2 billion Christians around the world who have an interest in reopening the cold case. The faith of believers is what sustains us, and it never diminishes, no matter how tough the time gets. Your faith in God will help you get through and to know that God is still God. He is still our God, whose power never weakens. He's still our God. Grace will never disappoint. Love will never be diminished. Promises will never fail. He is our God because His glory will never fade. His joy will never end. His foundation will never shake. His truth will never change. He will supply your every need. Yeah, my brothers and sisters, we must consider that those who reopened the cold case on Easter Sunday morning found the truth that everybody knows to be the facts, that Christ lives, and He gives us hope that tomorrow we will have a better day than today. The crucifixion and death of Christ was a cold case, but it was not a closed case. It was not closed because the unseen hand of God was moving to bring new life to a dead situation. The disciples witnessed the glory, to reopen this cold case would mean believing that the man they saw crucified, dead and buried, was alive and well. Reopen opening the cold case was a circumstance of hope lost and found again. Reopening the cold case required a leap of faith to believe that God walked up to the jaws of death, stared in his ugly face, walked through to the other side, shouted back to say that you can do greater things than this. I'm so glad that as I come to a close, that they were close by when he was tried in a kangaroo court. They were close by when Herod mocked and ridiculed him. They were close by when they was handed over to the soldiers for crucifixion. They watched as he carried the cross up Golgotha's hills. They watched as they nailed his hands and nailed his feet. They watched, as the sun refused to shine. They watched as the earth reeled and rocked like a drunken man. They watched as saints got up and start stirring around in the city of Jerusalem. They watched as the centurion soldier looked up at that awful scene at Calvary and said, "Surely he must be the Son of God." They were there and saw the stone rolled away. For the disciples, there was considerable evidence of Christ's death. To reopen this case was a testimony and evidence that he was alive. Today, there ought to be somebody sitting in here whose face the prospect of failure, defeat, and hopelessness. The world has given up on their case. They've been written off. Do I have a witness? The message of resurrection is that the cold case has been reopened. Hope is still alive. Failure can be overcome. The power of God can never be diminished, and hope can come forth. When Joseph was thrown in a pit to die, he looked like a cold case. But the truth is that God reopened the cold case, raised up Joseph to minister over Egypt. When Lazarus died, looked like a cold case. Mary and Martha met Jesus, said, "Lord, if you'd been here, our brother would not have died." But despite the sadness of the moment, the Lord reopened the case and gave Lazarus a brand new life. When the three Hebrew boys were thrown in the fiery furnace, there were many who saw the hot fires licking out on the plain of Dura. They said, "This is a cold case." But I'm so glad that we serve a God who can reopen the cold case. Ezekiel was carried in a valley of dry bones. It was a cold case. And asked the question, "Son of man, can these bones live?" The answer came that they can live if you hear the word of the Lord. I heard Isaiah say, "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes," I said, "by his stripes We are healed. On Sunday morning, they reopened the case and found out that he's alive. And because he lives, he reopened my cold case. Do I have a witness? Because he lives, I can face a day standing on the promises of God. Because he lives, I can get up out of the mess and start all over again. Because he lives, there's no mountain so high that I can't climb. Because he lives, there's no valley that I can't cross. Because he lives, there's no defeat that I can't have victory. Because he lives, there's no failure that can conquer my soul that hold me down. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all faith is gone. Because I know who holds the future. Do I have a witness? I'm so glad that he lives. He lives. He lives. He walks with me and he talks with me. He lives and he's alive. He's well. Do I have a witness? Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I believe he lives. He lives. He walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me.